here. I know the weather's getting better, and I know there's that temptation to be somewhere else on Wednesday night after a long, hard day, but I'm glad you have made the effort to be here tonight. It's good to have John and Tammy again with us, and just welcome to the family, the Somerville Family Worship Center, and we just really feel like we're a family of God here, and we're just glad all of you are here. And I don't have a funny joke like Courtney had, so I'm going to get back into talking about holiness. I'm going to get real serious. She's, you know, she's good cop, I'm bad cop, you know how that goes tonight. But we're going to go right back into what we've been talking about. So what I'm going to have you do tonight is turn to James chapter 4. That's going to be really the emphasis of where we're going to be tonight. But we mentioned the last few weeks this passage of Scripture in our study, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. It says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord, just even earlier, God, the peace that I felt, Lord God. I thank you for the peace that we feel in this church, God. I believe we have a group of people that love you and they love each other, God. And Lord, I pray the enemy would love to do nothing, God, but destroy that. But I believe that we serve a God. I pray through the power of your Spirit, Lord God, that raises up a standard that resists against that, God. And we, Lord, can allow the Holy Spirit to flow through us, Lord God, so that, Lord, you're loving through our loving. You're speaking through our speaking. Lord, you're operating, God, through the people of this church to reach our families, to reach this community with the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we just thank you for your love, God. Help us to realize not tonight that you love us, God, every one of us in this room, God. We may be in different places on our journey with you, but God, you are walking with us, every one of us, and you love us. You're directing our paths tonight. God, I just pray, Lord, in this place, change us, God. Change our hearts, God, our desires, God, to want to please you completely, Lord. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We talked about last week this mentality of how close can we get to the edge in this world and not fall away from the faith. And that's something that we seem to contend with. We defined and talked about legalism. We talked about how that's a double-edged sword. Somebody comes along, says you should not do this or you should not do that. And sometimes our immediate response is, well, that's legalism. But you see, it's legalistic thinking, I said, that prohibits, and it's also legalistic thinking that permits sometimes. It's the same thinking, just different sides of the coin many times. You mean that's permitted? That wasn't permitted at the last church that I was in. I think I'll stay here because you all feel like that's okay. Oh, you prohibit that? Well, praise God. Just, Pastor, just lay it to them. Just, you know, sometimes people have this attitude. Man, just rake them over the coals. We really need to be asking in this hour is not how close we can get to the edge, not what is prohibited, what's permitted. We need to be asking how close can we get to Him. And I believe when we do that, that takes care of the questions of what's prohibited, what's permitted. I believe His Word etched on the tables of our hearts is going to take care of a lot of those questions. We need to be asking, how close can I get to Him? And when I get close to Him, not only am I concerned about whether or not something is sin, I get concerned about, is there a weight in my life? It may not necessarily be sin, but is it causing me not to run the race as effectively as I can, not to be everything that I can be for God? What you do or don't do, I told you last week, comes down to this. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. It's about a love relationship with Jesus. The commandments of Christ are eternally scripted by the Spirit of the living God on the fleshly tables of our heart. And all of a sudden, Jesus means more to us than anything else. And we love Him enough that, hey, we don't desire to live close to the edge. We desire to live close to Him. And that attitude of repentance, I told you, it drives you towards Him. Lord, I will obey your words. I will live filled and led by your Spirit. And as we do that, he appropriates grace into our lives to become more and more like Jesus, to live holy because he's holy. That's where we need to be tonight. Boy, it's a tough crowd tonight. You guys are looking winded tonight or something. Smile at me. Smile at your neighbor. Amen. Tell them our preacher's crazy tonight. Amen. But folks, that's where we need to be. A first-class, red-hot fanatic for Jesus Christ. It's the only real joy in the Christian life. So I want to push on this a little further tonight and go back to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. The writer said, follow peace. You know, we haven't talked much about that portion of that scripture. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. And if you study the chapter, it talks about the discipline of the Lord. Things that he allows, things that we go through. They may seem painful, but the writer tells us if we're trained by that, afterwards it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness, and it seeks to conform us to God's will and to pleasing him. So I want to take a look at James chapter 4 tonight. Verse 1, it says, from whence come, or where comes wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence even of your lusts that war in your members? Now I'm just going to be real with you tonight, okay? I hope I'm that way every time I come, but I'm just going to be just upfront and real with you. I'm not addressing any specific problem. Tonight is not pointed to anything or anybody, so do not let your mind race into places it does not need to go tonight, okay? I'm just making an observation from the Scripture tonight that I believe is applicable to the hour in which we are living. And this is the earthly brother of Jesus, James. He's asking the question, what leads to the quarrels and conflicts among you brethren? Then he goes on to say, do they not come from your own lusts? Do they not come from your own desires? Do they not come from your own pursuits and your own pleasures? You see, I want to blame it on the devil. That's what we all do. Well, this is what the devil's doing to me. James doesn't give us that option here. James says there's something coming out of you. Your own lust, your own desires, pleasure that makes war, he said, in your members. The conflict, he's saying, between me and you is coming out of me. I've got a war going on inside of me. And he's saying because you don't resolve that war inside of you, you don't have peace. And I end up at war with you. Now, it can be two people, it can be 200 people. But just one person stirring the pot. Have you ever been in that situation? Just one person prone to conflict. One person that can't make peace because they've got this war going on inside of them. So here's the principle. Interpersonal conflict, conflict that rises between people, rises from intrapersonal conflict, conflict that's deep inside of me. Now let's go a little further tonight. People at peace with themselves are people of peace. And people who are at war with themselves are conflicted. And they engage in conflict with others. So James is saying, why do you have this fighting going on among the brethren all the time? These quarrels. Now here is a denominational church study. It says there is a crisis in the church on average every 18 months. So why is all this crisis stuff going on in churches today? James says it's because we're not dealing with the issues deep inside of us. We're really at the same place where we were last week. How close to the edge can we get? Conflict inside of me, no peace, no joy in the Christian life. It's really the same place. And the only way that we really ever get to the place that we really need to be is to turn around and make a beeline towards the old rugged cross and hug the blood-stained cross and decide, this is going to cost me something to serve the Lord, and I'm willing to pay whatever the cost is to have the peace of God inside of me. I look at Rob back there. Man, look at him smiling. He can't help but smile. Man, it's not just because he's just nice. He is. Man, he's like talking to Mr. Rogers sometimes. I'm waiting for him to sit up here one day and start changing his shoes and putting his sweater on it. Won't you be my neighbor? I love him. He gets up there and sings. And the reason it's such a joy to watch him is because there's a peace. But that peace isn't just because it's in his chemical makeup. It comes from deep within inside. Here's the bigger principle. Do you know that one of the concerns of Jesus is that we would be a people of peace? Every evangelist is to be a man of peace. You see, our key verse in this study of holiness, we said, follow peace, he says, with all men and holiness, without which, he said, no man shall see the Lord. Our feet, folks, the Bible tells us, are to be shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Luke chapter 10, Jesus sent the disciples out and said, when you come to a new house or a new place, what do you speak over that house? Peace, he said. Your whole purpose is to bring peace to that house and to bring peace into that city, that peace offering, that fellowship offering. There's no fellowship without peace. It was the crowning offering. It came after repentance, after restitution, after consecration. So basically, you get right with God, that's repentance. You get right with others, that's restitution. And then and only then is there the possibility of fellowship. God wants for me to have peace, to have His peace, which passeth all understanding. It's beyond comprehension. One of the passages that I love, yet it works on me at the same time, is John chapter 16, verse 33. Everything's falling apart here. Jesus is at the end of his life. He's facing the cross. Judas is about to sell him out. Peter's about to deny him. The disciples, they're going to run in every direction and they're going to abandon him. And he says, fellas, I need to make an announcement. I need to just tell you something before all Hades breaks loose here. Because they had no idea what was coming. He said, I've overcome the world. I've conquered the world. These things, he said, I've spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. He said, in the world, you're going to have tribulation. But he said, be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. You can have peace, fellas, because I've overcome the world. Everything's falling apart, it looks like. The crowds aren't there anymore. When I told them, Jesus said, when you had to drink my blood and eat my flesh, everybody turned away and went a different direction. He said, I need to tell you something. In the world, you're going to have trouble. You're going to have trials and tribulation. That's a guarantee. That's a promise. But he said, in me, you'll have peace. You see, the capacity to have everything storming around you, and to be able to say, hey, I've overcome the world. In the world, he said, you're going to have trouble, tribulation, but in Jesus, I can have peace. I just got laid off, but I've overcome the world. Doc, did you say I had the C word? Man, I've overcome the world. Folks, the ability to stand in the middle of all this mess And if you don't think there's a mess going on out there, you need to open your eyes, because it is. It's a mess. But we can go out in this mess and declare the peace of God. And it will keep your heart and your mind through Christ Jesus. You see, that's what faith is really all about. And you can never really deal with the conflicts around you unless you settle the conflict that is inside of you. Unless you have the peace of God that passes all understanding. Unless you let Him be the Lord of your life. And you are absolutely convinced that nothing will separate you from the love of God. This stuff didn't take Jesus by surprise. You see, many times man, I didn't see that coming, Lord. How could you miss that, Lord? Nothing takes Him by surprise. This craziness that's going on in our government, man, all this stuff, the last few years, maybe even your illness, none of those things has taken Him by surprise. Everything that comes into your life, He uses to His advantage and for His glory and for your good. And somehow we end up better. We would have been sons of Adam. But now, folks, we're sons of the living God. You see, when God fixes it, He fixes it better than it was before. You've got to have peace. Do you have peace tonight? I feel like the last few years, everything that's gone on since COVID, I feel like what it's done to the church and the people of God, it's stealing our peace. It's stealing our fellowship that comes from the real peace of God. So I say tonight, you got to have peace. Do you have peace? Or are you conflicted? Is the war that you're in with somebody at the office, is that your war? Is the strife that you're in your relationships, is that your war? Is that your strife? Do you have peace in yourself? Is there interpersonal stuff that you're going through that really is just bubbling up from your own volcano of conflict inside of you? Are you a man or a woman of peace tonight? Interpersonal conflict comes from interpersonal conflict. You see, if it's a mess this way, it'll be a mess this way. It will. If you're constantly battling with who you are this way, you're going to constantly battle with everybody else this way. Now, I want us to see three statements in James tonight. Verse 2, he says, ye lust, or ye desire, and ye have not. He said, ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight in war, he said, and ye have not. He said, you desire, but you don't have. You kill. You covet and desire. Your desire is what others have, and yet your lust still goes unfulfilled. Because even after you kill that job or kill that joy or kill that peace, that desire is even greater. And you cannot obtain. He says, so you fight and you war. So what you have is this unbridled desire followed by blocked goals, followed by aggression, and the pattern just repeats over and over and over again. I want, and I feel like you are standing in the way of me getting what I want, so I'm going to kill. I may not literally kill you, but I can kill your reputation. I can kill our relationship. I can kill the joy in my life. You'll not have any peace on this job or in your marriage or in that house, etc. Then here is the stunning statement James says, yet ye have not because ye ask not. James is asking them, why haven't you prayed about this? Why didn't you go to God and talk to God about this? Verse 3 says, ye ask. Oh, okay, well, now you have asked God about it, but you received not because he said ye ask amiss. that ye may consume it upon your own lusts. Now you're wanting others to do what God could not do for you. What's the problem? The problem is you're asking amiss. How do you know you're asking amiss? You're asking amiss when you want to spend an answer on your own pleasure or your own lusts. That's when you're asking amiss. God refuses to answer prayers that are merely for the advancement of selfish desires. I'm sorry the guy on TV told you something different. I hope you didn't send in that seed to him because you felt good about what he told you now. Oh, somebody just backed up on me, didn't they? That's not what prayer is all about. That's not where God is wanting to take you with prayer. The Amplified text says, now listen to this, this is pretty plain. You ask with the wrong purpose and even selfish motives. Your motivation is when you get what you desire to spend it in sensual pleasures. That's pretty plain. Your prayers are not answered, he said, because you've got selfish reasons. Young's literal translation says, when you ask amiss, you're praying in an evil way because you want to consume or spend the answer on your own pleasure. Hebrews 11 verse 6 says, but without faith it's impossible to please him. So what's that about? It's about faith. Then he says, for he that cometh to God. Now what's that about? That's about prayer. So without faith it's impossible to believe, to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is. What's that about? That's about faith again. So notice, effective prayer is wrapped up on both sides. If you're going to come to God and get an answer to prayer, you must have faith. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek what? You mean not diligently seek answers? Not diligently seek direction? Not diligently seek a breakthrough, or not diligently seek revival. Not diligently seek the salvation of souls. No, he says he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Notice the focus and function of prayer. He said those who diligently seek him. So what have you been seeking? Answers? Direction? You know, we do that all the time. Lord, lead, guide, and direct us. All three of those, one of each one, they all mean the same thing. But we, you know, oh, lead, guide, and direct us. It'd be fine if he just did one of those. The focus of prayer is to seek him. So we see that he comes to God. He that comes to God must believe two things. He must believe that he is, that God exists. I'm not just in there talking to the walls. And two, you must believe that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. If I am diligently seeking him, he is what? It says he's a rewarder. Notice where faith is applied here. Faith is not applied to the ability of God, but it's applied to the character of God. He's a God who rewards. He's a God who's good. You see, the fundamental attack in prayer by the enemy will not be the question of whether or not God can. You see, we talk about that all the time. Do you believe God can? Do you believe God can? But what the enemy's going to try to attack in your prayer life will be the question, since he can, why doesn't he? If nothing's impossible for him, then why doesn't he do this? You remember the words of Satan in the garden? Hath God said? Is that really what he told you all? Did he really say this would happen if you ate of that fruit? I said, are you kidding me, guys? If you just eat a little bit of that, you mean everything is going to fall apart. From the very beginning, the most effective strategy of Lucifer has been to bring into question the character of God. The Bible tells us, so tribulation, persecution, famine, peril, nakedness, sword, things high, things low, all these things, they come to separate you from the love of God. But they can't. You see, we like to want, well, if he really loved me, this wouldn't be happening. If there's a loving God, he would not let these kind of things happen. You hear those arguments all the time. And there's some theology out there that tries to put off suffering and outside the realm of God. That's the way some deal with or try to understand suffering. But you're better off tonight to understand that even God allows some difficult things. He allows some suffering. Why? Because he wants glory himself. Not just in delivering you from things, but delivering you through things. God's not just wanting you to have no thorns on your roses or no runs in your hoses. The Bible said it rains on the just and the unjust. And the miracle of our faith is that we praise God not just because we're delivered from something. Who wouldn't do that? If God delivered you from something, anybody would praise him. But we praise him in the middle of the fire. We praise God when they're throwing us in. We praise God when the fourth man shows up and says, I'm right here beside you. And I tell you what, here's another hard one. We praise God when we don't think he shows up. You see, that's what causes the world to back up and wonder what you have. What is there about you? Why are you happy all the time? What's inside of you that's not inside of me? Folks, we don't have just hope in this life, but our greatest hope is in the life and the world to come. We can see beyond the visible to another world, to another dimension that is descending down on this one. So here's what the evil one, our adversary, the devil, wants to do. He doesn't want to attack your faith in the ability of God as much as he wants to attack your faith in the character of God. Now, if we were to study some of the positions of prayer, one of the positions of prayer, Luther said, it's the default of prayer, is God help me. I pray that one all the time. It's the most natural way we pray. But I want to help us to understand that really doesn't need to be our first position in prayer. Another position is God use me. You know, we love this purpose-driven life. I want to be part of something that's bigger than me. I want to be significant in my life. I want to see his hand moving in my life, through my life, touching, ministering to other people. That's a great prayer. That's a noble prayer, but that can't be our first position. Our first position must be, God, I know that you love me. And I love and worship you with all of my heart. Let me tell you what happens to me in prayer. It may not work this way with you. I don't know. But many times I rush in to prayer, frantic. God, help me. God, help me. Just frantically praying. And really, I'm just making noise because of the noises that are in my own heart. It's not really praying. It's just making noise. I'm kind of like a child screaming at his father. But mature Christians, we need to push back those God help me prayers and all the temptation to pray God use me prayers, especially us ministry leaders. Man, God use me, use me. All the God help me, all the God use me prayers, we need to really push those back and settle down and pray, God, I know that you love me. I know that you love me. You see, we don't love God into loving us. God, I'm going to behave today. I'm going to let people in when they cut me off on the freeway. I'm going to be kind and nice. I'm going to smile to everybody. I'm not going to raise my voice. So by 6 p.m., God, you will love me. No, that's just religion. That's all that is. We love Him because He first loved us. God commended, or He committed His love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It's His love that enables our love. We don't even love Him with our own love. It's agape love that comes down from heaven. The Bible said in Romans chapter 5, the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us. The love that you love Him with has been given to you. And folks, when you truly get it, that He loves me, there's a joy in your heart. Thank you, oh God, that you love me. And that's the love that we send back to Him. And out of that truth, He loves me and I love Him. That overflows onto other people. Let me say, if you just have a moment at the beginning of a stressful day and you push back, if you can, all the God help me and all the God use me stuff, and you just have a moment in the morning when you just get it, Lord, I know that you love me. I know it, God. I sense it. Let me ask you something. What happens to the all the God help me stuff? It seems to go on the back burner for a few minutes. You see, your fundamental need, your fundamental problem, the fundamental struggle of your faith is your struggle in your relationship with Him. Because all those things that are threatening the strength of your relationship with Him, and your peace is disturbed until you settle that. You don't settle the peace problem with peace. You settle the peace problem by going back to God and saying, God, I know that you love me. You can't say, Lord, if you'll do this for me, if you'll help me get this deal done today, if you can just give me that position or that promotion, then, Lord, I will know that you love me. Folks, He's already given His Son. He already surrendered His Son on a cross. He's already gone to the funeral of His Son for you. And yet we're over here saying, Lord, hold on. Let me get your attention. Can you just come over here? Let me fleece you for a minute. Lord, if you'll do this for me, then I know that you love me. Let the cross be proof enough of His love. So going back to Hebrews, he said, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Are you growing in your prayer life? Is your soul desire to please Him? Lord, is my life pleasing you? So we must have faith. We must believe that He is God. And there's also this thing in Hebrews that says He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. You see, when Jesus teaches on prayer in Matthew chapter 6, He said, but when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. Or He's saying your most private room. And when you've shut your door, pray to the Father which is in secret, and the Father which seeth in secret, He says, will reward thee openly. The idea here is that when I go into my secret place, He's there waiting. He's listening. He wants to meet with me there. And your Father, who sees all this that goes on in secret, says He will reward you openly. This is the nature of the Father. Because the Father knows what we need even before we ask. Let me say, the reward of praying is different than an answer to prayer. In fact, I've about come to the conclusion getting an answer to prayer is lesser of all the outcomes of prayer. That may surprise you tonight, because most of us pray to get an answer. But the Bible says we don't even know what we should ask for. We don't even know what we need. Look at the things that you asked for. What if God gave them all to you? Ruth Graham, Billy Graham's wife, said, I would have married the wrong man 7 times if God had answered all my prayers. See, we don't even know how to ask without the Holy Spirit asking for you. You see, here's what I believe tonight. I think if you will seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, if you will diligently seek Him, not just answers. I'm not saying you can't seek after answers. Not just direction. I'm not saying you don't need to seek after direction. But not just a breakthrough. Seek after breakthroughs. You see, I don't want to just lay hold of the answer. I want to lay hold of the one who answers. You see, Job finally came to that place. Everything he faced and everything he had gone through and everything that the Lord had allowed him to go through, God let him know, Job, I am your answer. I'm your answer. You're looking for the answer. I am the answer. I'm not after something from your hand, God. I'm after you. I want you. I want a relationship with you. Here's what I found. If we will diligently seek Him, you know what happens? Things start popping into our life. These are the rewards of praying. Many of those things, I don't even ask for them. God starts bringing these things into my life. Well, God, I didn't even pray for that. I didn't even ask for that. I couldn't even imagine that I needed that. You see, I remember as a young man, I grew up, and when I was younger, up to about the age of John Luke, I was with my mom a lot. My dad worked swing shift. I didn't see him as much. He wasn't at the house when I was at the house a lot of times. But around John Luke's age, I started really getting to know my dad. And I don't even remember what happened. It was just I started spending more time with him. We bonded. I started getting interested in who he was and what he liked and the things that he liked. I started spending a lot more time with him. If he crawled under a car, I crawled under a car. If he went to a gun show, I went to the gun show. If he did this or that, I was with him. And I would ask him if I could go with him, if I could ride with him, if I could be with him. And I started spending time with him, and I began to realize as I did that, I didn't have to worry about things. Dad was going to take care of me. Dad wasn't just this disciplinarian that my mom always told me, if you don't quit, I'm going to tell your dad. And then he swoops in and has to take care of the issue or whatever. I begin to realize, man, my dad's a good guy. My dad wants the best for me. My dad loves me. And my dad loves to spend time with me. And I realized he's going to take care of me. If I needed something, he was the kind of father that already knew what I needed before I even asked. He had a better plan than I expected. I remember when I was 16, I thought, there's no way I can buy a car. My dad told me, you're going to have to buy your own car. Mom, Dad, they said, we're not going to buy it for you. And I thought, well, man, how am I going to afford a car? You know, Kroger's, $4.25 an hour. It's a little rough. So I find a $500 car. It was a Pontiac Firebird. It had a V6 in it, and the belt squeaked. And it looked like it had been driven through every Michigan winter that existed. But it's $500. And I thought, $500, I'm going to have wheels. I can at least get to school, back, whatever, with my friends. And I thought, I'll clean it up. It'll look all right. And so I told my dad, I said, hey, I'm thinking about talking to Debbie down here at the car lot about this car she's got out there. She said she'd sell it to me for $500. He said, you want a Firebird? I said, well, no, Dad, that's not like my first choice. He said, if you want a Firebird, let me show you a Firebird. He takes me to the next town over, and there sits this beautiful black and gold Trans Am. Gold honeycomb wheels, gold ground effects, black everything. And I said, Dad, I can't afford that. He said, I think you can. I said, what do you mean? He said, I think it's got some miles on it. I think the price will be enough for you to get a little small loan from your aunt at the bank, and as long as you can pay the payments, I'll co-sign for the loan. And he said, I think you can afford it. I said, Dad, they'll want a fortune for that car. I come back. He comes out. He said, $3,000, John. The guy wants $3,618. He said, your payment will be $100 a month. He said, you think you can afford that on your Kroger's salary? I said, yeah. I took that thing home and I shined it up. It looked like a brand new car. I rolled up in the parking lot at school. Somebody told me, said, man, how in the world did you pull the wool over your dad's eyes to get that? Well, my dad knew. You know, that was in the smog pump era and everything. There was like 100 and something horsepower in that car. It had a V8 in it. But I drove up, and one of the kids said, after he got to know me, he said, I thought you were one of them rich kids in that car that you drove. You see, Dad knew what I needed. And he said, hey, why are you going to settle for that mess when I've got something over here that I've had my eye on that's just what you need? And I drove that car for years to come, and I was it, man. Didn't have air conditioning. 265, though. Two windows down, running 65 miles an hour. But I looked good. But Dad knew what I needed. But I can look back now, and the greatest thing I ever got from my dad, it wasn't cars, guns, or things. It was him. It was time with him. You see, we stood out there and washed those cars together. You know, and washing a car with my dad was more valuable than the car was. There was a peace just being with him, just knowing that he was there. And tonight, if you're discouraged because you're not getting the answers you're looking for, look at your life. Do you think those blessings in your life just happened? Or that breakthrough that you needed just came? Do you think that favor just came to you? No. It's the reward of seeking him and his kingdom, and putting him first and foremost in your life. And these things begin to happen around you. Doors open. Things you didn't ever dream about. It's the reward of seeking him and putting him first in your life. Matthew chapter 6, 6 times in this chapter the word reward is used. There's a reward for giving, a reward for praying, and a reward for fasting. Not just to be seen, but you do it sincerely. He says, your Father himself will reward you openly. You see, there's a reward for these spiritual disciplines in our life. And the reward, it's not the same as an answer. Prayer, giving, fasting. You see, prayer relates to your time. The biggest problem people say why they don't pray, I don't have time. Listen to me tonight. I love you. I'm your pastor. If you don't have time to pray, your life's out of control. If you don't have time for God, you've got a problem. You can't fix your marriage on shower and commuting to work prayers. Lord, help me. Help me today. Lord, just make her think, know that I love her. Just work this all out, God. Oh, God, help me. Help me. Oh, whoa, I almost hit that car. Please, Lord, help me. You know what? That's when we think, man, I'm going to work some time in here. You got to have quality time with God. You can't just depend on this church to cultivate your relationship with God. You may not be able to spend an hour in your closet every day, or your most quiet or inner room. But there ought to be those moments where you get alone with God, where you say, I am pulling away from this world. Lord, I have made time that is just for you. It's not time that I'm sharing with you in the car. It's not time I'm sharing with you in the shower. It's not time that I'm sharing with you doing something else. This time, I've devoted it just to you, Lord. You know, one of the major problems in Pentecostal churches today, people like to depend on the fire in the heart of the pastor. They think we're the game changer. Man, I hope we. Yeah. They think, man, I'm going to turn it all around. I'm going to tell you, you didn't get a game changer. I've got a great weight. I've got a great responsibility. I'm going to tell you. You know how many prayer requests I get? You think, well, I just sent Brother John one this week. Yeah, multiply that by 200. The Bible says you need to pray for yourself before you go to the elders of the church. I'm not telling you not to ask me. I want to pray for you. But I'm just saying, don't depend on me to be your lifeline to God. There ought to be those moments where you get alone with Him. We have lost what it means to pray until you pray through. When I have a problem where I just go somewhere and I get on my knees and I don't get up until I've heard from heaven. And when I get up, there's a peace that I know. I may not have got the answer, but I know that there's a peace that God is in control and everything is going to be all right. Let me tell you, how you spend and steward your time as it relates to prayer is the number one control factor in your entire life. If you've developed a disciplined prayer life, it's the control point of your life all the time. Fasting. Oh, preacher, fasting. Let me see. Fasting's not just giving up food, but also by permission of your spouse. The Apostle Paul tells us that we pull away from our intimate encounters too. Paul says you only do that when you come away for a time of prayer and fasting, because the two dominant drives in your life are the satisfaction of your flesh by food and intimacy. He's saying you got to push those desires of the physical, fleshly man down so that the spirit man rises up inside of you and you're hungrier from bread from heaven that comes from heaven than you are bread that feeds your physical man. You know, it takes three or more days before your body really kicks into a new metabolism in that time of fasting. 3, 4, 5 days before toxins get released from your body, all the sugar, all of that mess, you think, man, I hate to even get into it. First couple of days are rough. But then all of a sudden you begin to think clear. All of a sudden you're unencumbered by all the stuff that this flesh cries out for. Why? Because the only thing that you're feeding during that time is your spirit man. You see, most of us are not spirit, soul, and body. Most of us are body, soul, and spirit. When the body calls, it's over. Fasting is a control point for all things physical. When you push food and those physical desires aside and you have your body under control so your spirit man can rise up. Giving. Giving is the control point for all things material. Somebody said to John Wesley, "Sir, your house is burning down." He said, "It's not my house." He said, "It's the Lord's house." He said, "Thanks be to God for one less thing to worry about." That probably would not be our response tonight. You know, we're too attached to this world and its things. And many times, those things own us. We can't give it away because they own us. We can't fast because the flesh rules. We can't pray because our time and our life is out of control and we're reacting and we're not acting. Three control points in our life Jesus gives us right here in Matthew chapter 6. Give, pray, fast. Brings your being under control, brings your time under control, brings all things material under control. And he says in verse 33, if you will do these things, if you will seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, all these things will be added unto you. He comes back to this notion that if you will do these things, there's a reward. There is a reward. There is a bigger reward than just an answer. If you will begin to seek God, He will begin to reward you. If you go to God with your and your whole prayer life is consumed with, God, will you answer this? Will you do this? Will you make this happen? Would you give me this sign? God, are you? Can I throw this fleece out and you tell me if I need to do this or not? It can't just be about that. Prayer is the place where you do ask God for things. Prayer is the place where you make requests. Prayer is the place where you clarify your priorities. Prayer is the place where you open the Bible and wrestle with what the will of God is. But the bottom line is, God, what I really want is you. If you will begin to pray that way, I just believe what His Word says. I believe He'll reward you. And the reward of praying will be greater than the answer that you're looking for. Man, there's a reward in praying and seeking Him because God's bigger than you are. And He'll give you great and mighty things that you didn't even have a knowledge of, that you didn't even know about. He'll give you things you didn't even ask for. So James says in our text, he asks, what leads to the quarrels among you? He said, do they not come from your desires? The problem is, many times we're a friend of the world. We're too close with the world. He said, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? He said, you're cheating on God with the world. He says, whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Verse 5, do ye think that this scripture says in vain, the spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? Or the spirit that dwells in us yearns jealousy? Now what does that mean tonight? That sounds a little strange. It means while I'm praying for flimsy, fleshly little things, things that consume my prayer life many times, buried under the rubble of my flesh, buried under my hunger for things, the Holy Spirit is yearning. He's jealously waiting and longing to pray for you. He wants to pray His prayer because He knows what the blueprints of your life look like in heaven. He knows what God has put in you. He knows what could come out of your life. And if I could ever get the body and soul under the control of the Spirit, if I could ever get to that place that we can say, God, my only desire is to know You and to seek You with all of my heart. He's saying the Spirit jealously yearns that I could give myself completely to Him so that God can love through my loving. He can speak through my speaking and care through my caring until the invisible God is made visible in me to everybody around me. You see, when I use terms like betrayal, denial, hurt, wounded, nails, rejection, lies, false accusations, what place am I talking about? Calvary. And folks, God will lead you there all the time. The Bible said you're crucified with Christ. The Bible said your sins were nailed to the cross with Him. The Bible said you're buried with Him. The Bible said you're resurrected with Him. You weren't even there. But it's as if you were. Because Calvary happens over and over and over again in your life. You get betrayed. You get nailed. You get mocked. You get to the place many times you wonder what's going on. You think, man, I'm about to lose it all. And Paul said when we came to the end of ourselves, he said, that was good. When we had no more strength left in us, he said, that was good. Because we prayed. And the only one who we could turn to is God. Who even raises the dead, he said. And he did raise us up again. One more time, he did it again. You know why you're where you are today? It's not your job. It's not your money, your experience, your education. It's that God needed a man or woman of God in the middle of the mess that's going on. And as difficult as it is in this life so many times, it's not about you. You're part of something bigger than you. So the wars and the fightings going on around you, they need a woman or man of peace. They need a man or woman of integrity. This community needs a church filled with people of peace. They don't need to walk in here and see people that are going at it against each other, strife and envy and division and jealousy and all those things. What they need is to find people of peace. They need a man who says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." They need to ask and see the grace of God flowing in your life. They need to see the resurrection power in your life. They need to see a Savior that says, "I've overcome the world. And if I've done it, you can do it." The cross is not so you can get a little cabin over in the corner of glory. I'll be honest, that song gripes me. I know it's just my pet peeve, but you know, we strum up there and people, "Woo, man, I just want a cabin over in the corner of glory." What a discount of what God has for you. How crazy is that? Man, the cross isn't so we can go to Disney World when we die. The cross is what we embrace day after day so you can have the power of the resurrection. How do you praise God through all this? How do you have joy through all of this? How do you have peace in all of this? Because it isn't my joy. It isn't my peace. It's the joy of the Lord. I'm connected to another world that's breaking in through my life. So tonight, I'm asking us, are you a man or woman of peace? Or are you a person of conflict? Do you have peace inside of you? Do you have peace flowing out of you? Sometimes the only place to settle your issues is the old therapy called prayer. 10 sessions with the pastor cannot do with what one session on your knees and staying there until tears start running out of your eyes, until the presence of God begins to move in. You lay it all out. You wrestle with it. You pray until the burden lifts and the peace comes back in. That's praying until you pray through. And I'm going to tell you, it's going to do a whole lot better than 10 sessions with me. All I'm going to do is probably sit there and listen to you and then say, "Let's have prayer." You see, in the book of Samuel chapter 2, you remember Penina? She taunted Hannah. Hannah said, "I just smile at my enemies." "Nothing you say, Penina, is not going to get under my skin today." Proverbs 16:7 says, "When a man's way pleases the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him." Why? Because we've got victory in Jesus. In the middle of these troubled times, folks, he can make us a man or woman of peace. Man, that's my prayer for this church. I'm on guard all the time, watching. I feel like a man on a wall sometimes, but I'm praying, "Lord, you're Jehovah Shalom. You're the God of my peace and my prosperity. Let everything we touch in this church, everything we do, God, bring peace in it. I don't want a bunch of infighting and mess. I don't want people fighting over, well, I didn't get to be in charge of this or that." Man, I want us to see, man, hey, everything we're doing is trying to draw us closer to him. That if we'll seek him, that's the reward. If we'll diligently seek him, there's a reward. Because of that, there's a blessing. If we'll diligently seek him as a church, you know what the reward is? All of a sudden, he's blessing us with things we didn't even think about. All of a sudden, his spirit moves in a service, and we didn't even work up the shout. It just came in like a flood and overtook us all. And the power of the Spirit begins to move and work among us. I'm telling you, there's a reward for diligently seeking Him. You know why sometimes we have some amazing services in here? I believe it's because there's some people that go over there at 8 o'clock and seek the Lord. I believe there's some people in this church that get alone in their closet, in their quiet place, and they seek God until they pray through. We don't have to pray amiss. If we'll put Him first, I'm telling you, He'll give you everything you need. And this, all these stuff without, it'll go away if you'll get what's right within. If you'll get this right, this stuff out here will be right. You want peace out here? You got to have peace in here. You got to have peace with who He's called you and made you to be and say, Lord, I just want You. I just want You. Lord, I there's a need over here. I'm bringing it to You. I love You. But Lord, more than anything, I want You. I want Your will. I want Your purposes. I want Your way. If we'll put Him first, I believe He'll take care of everything that we need, and we will experience holiness through peace. You know, the Bible said make peace where it's possible. You say, well, sometimes, Brother John, it's not possible. There may be times where it's not possible, but I'm going to tell you, if you'll look and search pretty hard and seek Him and pray through, you'll find most of the time, there's a way of peace. And you'll have peace about it. And everybody else around you will have peace about it. James said, where do you think all that warring's coming from? He said, it's come from you. Come from deep down inside. He said, you need to get that settled with the Lord. I believe there's peace that passes our knowledge and understanding. You know, even he instructed us. He said, careful. Don't be full of cares for anything. He said, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests be made known unto God. And he said, the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You know what I find when I really dig in and I take the cares and lay my requests out and I really begin to pray through? All of a sudden, I find myself just wanting to be with Him, just wanting to know more of Him. And His peace comes in like a flood and it takes over. Peace, holiness through peace. Let's stand tonight. Here's what I'm going to do tonight. I know we've been coming to the altar and praying. Give me some peaceful people up here. You say, well, Brother John, how do you know who's peaceful? You know, my wife's a peaceful person. Come on, Courtney. You say, well, that's your wife. You know that she's peaceful. I know she's peaceful because I know what's going on in the inside many times. You know, she's able to just move away from all of that and settle that inside and say, Lord, You're going to handle it. You're going to take care of it. It's not a problem. Look at this guy right here, Eddie Tyler. I told his sister yesterday. I don't know if she agreed with me or not, but I was in North Carolina for a funeral. But I told her, I said, man, Eddie Tyler, I said, that's your brother? I said, Eddie brings a peace and a calm, I said, to everything we do. He walks into a board meeting and it's like, oh, the peacemaker is here. Man, he just smiles. Look at him. He's smiling right now. Man, he's just a peacemaker. Look, this guy right here. Pastor, it's all going to be okay. It's all going to be all right. With the storms raging around he and Nancy all the time, and he's like, man, he tells me this stuff. He says, man, I'm a thimble, and you can just pour the dump truck on. I'll take it and carry it. Or what is it?
I'm a dump truck and ain't nothing but a thimble.
Yeah, that's it. And I'm a dump truck and it ain't nothing but a thimble pouring on me. He said, man, I can carry the load. But it's because there's a peace inside. There's not conflict going on all the time. And why I ask them to come up here is because if you have got some conflict going on tonight, I want some peace to be imparted to you. It's going to come from Him, but I want somebody to lay hands on you that's peaceful. You see, we got to be careful who lays hands on us. You know, somebody may lay hands on you that's got an old spirit that's like a volcano about to erupt. So what I'm saying is tonight, if there's a conflict going on, hey, just come up here and let the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, flood your soul tonight. Say, Lord, I want to know you. Lord, I'm not so much concerned about the answer as I am about diligently seeking you. I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want to know who you are, God. I want to know the depths of your love. Somebody in here needs to realize God first loved you. We love Him because He first loved us. Somebody in here needs to understand that tonight. You wake up every morning and think, man, I just ain't good enough. I just can't do enough. That is legalism. That's saying, hey, I got to be saved, but then I've got to add this to it. That's what legalism is. What you need to realize is He died for you. He loved you so much. He went to the cross for you. He commended His love for you that while you were yet a sinner, He said, I'm going to do it for them. He loved you first. And because of that, you can receive Jesus Christ. And the love of Christ will drive everything that you do. He loves you tonight. If there's a conflict tonight in anybody's spirit tonight, just come. Don't worry about everybody else. Nobody's thinking anything tonight. All we're thinking about is, God, I want more of you. If you got something that's just weighing you down, it's a weight. I want you to come and let some of these pray for me tonight. If you just want to come and seek Him, this altar's open. Just come and find a place to pray tonight. If you just want to come and seek Him, you see, He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Come tonight. Let's find a place to pray in this place tonight, and let's just seek after Him. So, Lord, I want to know You. I want Your peace that passes my knowledge, God. I want to give every area of my life completely to You. I want that peace tonight. I want You to come. If anything, come and say, Lord, hey, don't allow these warnings that try to come into the church by the enemy. Don't let this stuff, Lord God, go on. Help us all to get peace within so we've got peace without. I want you to come and just pray tonight. Find a place at the seat where you're at, if that's all you can do tonight. Let's get before Him and say, Lord, I want to diligently seek You. Find a place tonight. Let's pray tonight. Let's pray in this place tonight. Amen. Amen. Let's find a place to pray all over this place. Maybe it's right in your seat. That's fine. Wherever you're comfortable tonight, let's diligently seek Him. Lord, we come to You in this place tonight. Lord, I thank You, Lord God, that, Lord, with my office door closed earlier, Lord, I just was standing, God, and there was a peace that came over me, God, that I know is only from You. It just passed my knowledge. Lord, in the midst of stress and trials and things going on, God, nothing, Lord, out of the ordinary, but just this life, the pressures of this life, people, Lord, struggling, going through things, God, I was able to stand in the midst of my Savior and begin to realize that, God, before the world was formed and fashioned and made, You loved me so much that You made a plan, God. You designed me, God. And Lord, I pray You have a plan for my life, and I pray that in this room, help every person here tonight know first that You love them. You love them. There's not going to be anything tomorrow that they can do to make You love them more. They love, Lord God, You because You first loved them. And God, I pray, Lord God, help us to get out of that mindset, God. That, Lord, it's about what we do. It's about asking for the right things, God. It's about seeking You, Lord. Lord, we don't want to ask amiss, but I believe when we begin to seek You, Lord God, we begin to ask for the things, God, I pray that you desire, God, that you want, God. You begin to fill our life up. We begin to know that, Lord God, by seeking you, Lord God, by allowing Holy Spirit to come and lead us, God, that, Lord, I pray you've got better plans for us than we ever thought about. And God, I pray in this church, Lord God, I want to become a people, Lord God, that are diligently seeking you, God, that we've got peace that passes the knowledge, God. The world doesn't understand it because, God, we have been after, Lord, who you are, God. We seek him. We believe that you are God. We believe that you can do all things, but, Lord, we also, Lord, seek who you are. We seek the attributes of God. We seek, Lord God, I pray, your holiness. We seek your righteousness. We seek your peace. We seek your joy. We seek that fruit that your Spirit, Lord God, comes into our life and bears on the branches of our life. We love you because, Lord, we realize that you loved us first. That you loved us first, God. That you went to a cross and died for us. God, tonight help us to grasp a hold of that. And God, let Somerville Family Worship Center continue to be a church filled with your peace. Filled with your peace. In every situation, God, I pray, Lord, let things and opinions and differences, God, easily be worked out because, Lord, the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, is keeping every heart and every mind in this place. Lord, we need your peace. Just flood this place with your peace. I felt it here earlier, God. I feel it moving and working tonight, God. If there's somebody here that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, if there's a conflict going on in their soul right now, if they're contemplating all of this, I pray that Holy Spirit would come in and they, Lord God, would believe by faith your word, which says, Lord God, if we will confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that Christ died and rose again, we can be saved. Lord, I pray, God, let that spirit of repentance, God, fill this church. Let us be people who are right with you, God, and right with others, God. Let us walk in that peace tonight, God. That peace, God, that only comes from you tonight. We thank you. We thank you for it tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you have peace tonight? Don't walk out of here in conflict, man. I love you tonight, every one of you. And I want you to know that peace that only comes from God, only comes from Him. That's it. He's the only source of it. Amen. Thank you for being here tonight. It's good again to have John and Tammy with us. So glad you're here. He told me that Shar grabbed him by the hand in Walmart and said, you need to be in church tonight. I thought, man, we need about 100 more Shars. But come to find out, that wasn't totally true. But I'm glad she invited them, and I'm glad they're here. And I hope you felt the peace of God in this place. We love all of you tonight. Thank you for all that you do. God's got great things for all of us. Come back this weekend. I know it's Memorial Weekend, but if you're in town, don't skip church. Come on anyway, amen? And we've got discipleship that